that's it! Fears you got here just in the nick of time. What does that make us?
Big damn heroes, sir.
Ain't we just?
Almost you'd be shooting at like a ghost-like image. Now, you wouldn't shoot a ghost with a real gun. You'd shoot a ghost with a ghost gun. And that's what this, which you could kind of equate this to.
So I'm thinking very, very hard of a laser beam just sort of blowing up Liz's head. Is that right?
That's about it.
Girls are tied to beds for two reasons. Sex and exorcisms. So which was it with you?
Hello and welcome to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM, the film and TV radio show, where a handful of film enthusiasts shoot the breeze about all things film and television. I am Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
And we have an unusual show today, and by unusual, we always like to mix it up. We're not going to have a top five favorites today, but we do have a jam-packed episode with interviews with two groups of people, very exciting people, very exciting filmmakers. The first will be our film and TV news, where we'll dive straight into our interview where we caught up with director of When the Screaming Starts and actor from When the Screaming Starts, Conor, Boru, who's the director, and Jared Rodgers, who's one of the actors in the project. And then in our spotlight section, we will dive in and talk to two filmmakers who have started up the Female Film Club, that is Nicole Lieberman and Liza van der Smissen, who are on the show talking to just myself, not to producer Dave, about their project, the Female Film Club. But before we do that, let's jump into film and TV news. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
And we're joined by director and actor in the film When the Screaming Starts. We brought this when myself and David had an on-set visit to the satirical comedy horror film When the Screaming Starts, and we spoke with the director and a number of cast and crew, and we're joined by them. Please tell us your names. We'll start with the director and move on to actor. Please tell us your names and where you are in the process of When the Screaming Starts.
Sure. So I'm Conor Boru. I'm the director. I'll let Jared introduce himself.
I'm Jared Rodgers. I'm an actor in the film.
Jay is actually being quite modest there because he's actually a producer as well.
Jared, you're not one of the writers, are you? Who was the writer of the project?
No, so Ed and Connor have been working on that. I can probably sort of attest to writing a line or something or recommending a line, but yeah, it's all Ed and Connor.
And Connor, as you're the director and one of the writers, please just remind our viewers, our listeners, what When the Screaming Starts is all about.
Absolutely. So When the Screaming Starts is a mockumentary about an aspiring and somewhat inept serial killer and the documentary filmmaker who's following him on his journey, trying to get his first murders under his belt. And obviously, everything unravels.
Exactly. And Jared, if I'm not mistaken, Jared plays the reporter. Is that correct, Jared?
That's right, yeah. Like, if you imagine, like, Louis Theroux on a very low budget, very kind of odd, quirky Louis Theroux guy.
Yeah, because when we came onto the set, we were ushered into this warehouse, very derelict looking warehouse, lovely location. And there was, I think it was a mattress in one corner and a whole bunch of other stuff with an assortment of characters, not mentioning who was there. If you want to check it out, just go onto our Instagram page. We've got tons of photos. Tell us, when we saw you last year, you were in the middle, you almost wrapped. What is the state of the project at the moment?
Well, yeah, that does seem like a lifetime ago now. at that point, we felt like we had nearly wrapped. We had like a couple of pickups that we wanted to do. But during the whole lockdown process, we were obviously working on the edit. And we just decided we had more scope in the story than we initially thought. So we used that time where we couldn't do much else to rewrite a couple of scenes that were existing, but mostly to add a whole series of new scenes to the film. Because it's a documentary, it kind of has that freedom to take things off into little tangents. We had certain characters where we could explore their backstories a little bit more. So we actually shot another 7 days on top of the initial 12-day shoot. So we shot a significant amount more, actually. And that was only last month. So, yeah, still pretty fresh.
Yeah, I remember seeing on your Instagram page, you had some photos that you'd taken on set. It was quite interesting to see some of you masked up and whatnot. Can you tell us some of the challenges that you faced actually shooting those extra scenes during the whole pandemic, during sort of such constraints? Can you give us some of an idea as to some of the measures that you took to make sure that everything was okay and you actually met sort of the code?
Yeah, well, from my point of view, from the producing side, I guess, it was a case of thinking about that even in the scripting stage and thinking about when we were rewriting scenes or adding scenes, is this going to be doable in a kind of COVID world? Whereas before that wouldn't have been part of the equation. So we started there, tried to minimize any scenes where people would have to be really close or have any unnecessary physical contact. And then just moving forward onto the actual shoot, it was a case of taking every measure we could to be as safe as possible, from, you know, temperature checks every day and all the health forms, risk assessments, making sure that cast and crew brought their own lunch, which was weird because we normally, you know, we like to feed the team, keep them well fed throughout the day. So down to the smallest things, like making sure tea and coffee was individually packaged, so you're minimizing risks in every way you possibly can, because I'm sure Jared feels the same. You feel an enormous weight of responsibility on your shoulders at a time like this. It was very much part of our conversations every day.
Absolutely, because obviously, I mean, this is a situation where if one person happens to contract coronavirus and they happen to bring it on set, that's essentially the entire crew being put at risk. So it's a brave feat, I have to say. You guys are far braver than I am. I barely stepped out of my house in this entire pandemic. We've done the entire show via Zoom. And it, you know, we don't know how long it's going to carry on. So more power to you, to yourselves. A lot of productions I know have shut down because of it. It's credit to yourselves to be able to come together and still shoot those extra scenes. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
Yeah, and I'm David Campbell. And just to correct you, we actually went on set this year. It was in January.
Was it this year?
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
It does. It feels like it was a lifetime ago.
It was pre-COVID. So yeah.
That's what COVID-19 has done. We're joined by Conor, Boru and Jared Rodgers, the director and actor from the mockumentary When the Screaming Starts. You can check out their Instagram page. It's When the Screaming Starts on Instagram. Is that across all social media, When the Screaming Starts?
So on Facebook and Instagram, it's at When the Screaming Starts. And then on Twitter, it's at When Screaming. At When Screaming, even.
Excellent. So we will put those in the show notes anyway. So when people are listening to this podcast on Monday, when it comes out, you can just click on those links and go straight to those social media sites. Now, you did those extra scenes. You shot those extra scenes. You've managed to, am I correct in understanding that you've now finally wrapped on production and you are currently in post-production? Or are you thinking, actually, there's somebody else to kill and we need to film that?
Oh. There is, I'd say, a tiny little kind of bit extra, which in the grand scheme of things, it is just maybe a one or 2 day, probably 2 days. But there's still a little bit extra. It's going to be fun. It's going to be very creative. I don't want to say too much because I don't want to give away spoilers, but there's going to be lots of really cool, interesting costumes and possibly some kind of face painting stuff and different masks and actual other masks than obviously the ones we'll be wearing for COVID reasons. But yeah, it's been a long journey, and credit as well to Conor and Alan as well, who I'm sure will be listening when this goes out in New York. Yeah, they've been crazy editing for the months as well, from we think when we kind of wrapped on the initial kind of block and what they put together as well. It's looking great.
Yeah, nearly there. It feels like we are finally, because, you know, it did hold us up a bit, obviously, with COVID, the reshoots. But yeah, we've got pretty much, I'd say, 97% in the can. We just need to get these extra few little bits and pieces, and then just trying to get it wrapped from the post-production side of things.
Excellent. David, I think you have a question.
Just wanted to ask about the cast, the rest of the cast. Do you know, have you been in contact with them? Do you know how they're doing at the moment and what they're doing as well to get work, if that's possible at the moment?
Yeah, so we touched base with a lot of the cast with the reshoots. I'd say like all the main cast, we pretty much had back for the pickups. Yeah, so it's a real mixed bag. I mean, some people still working more than ever. I mean, one of our lead actors, Yasin Ator, he just finished filming Young Wallander. Oh, that's just come out actually, but he's just
I was gonna say he's in Young Wallander, and he's gonna be in The Witcher, right, next
that's
season,
right? Yeah, I think he's just finished on The Witcher. Maybe he's doing a few more weeks at some point soon, but yeah, so he's been busier than ever, whereas some other people, you know, it's been tough. They've been hit hard, and especially those that worked a lot in theatre or musical theatre. I mean, of course, that whole industry is just completely dried up for the time being. So, yeah, a real mixed bag. I mean, people are obviously cautious about even making their own projects right now, because it's stressful right now to try and plan anything, because you just feel like at any point the plans change. Everyone's got a different sense of what's safe, what's not. Some people don't seem to really care at all, and other people are terrified. So,
no, you're absolutely right. Yeah, because and that's just going back to what I was mentioning earlier. A lot of productions have shut down because they're not able to ensure or guarantee the safety of their crew and their cast. You've heard about big projects like, take it for what it is, Rumors or Truth from the new Batman movie that's coming out, where even a production as big as that, crew members have contracted COVID and so on and so forth. So it's tough for productions, independent productions, to be able to come out and still do that. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
And we've got the director, producer, and the actor and one-line writer from the mockumentary When the Screaming Starts.
Jared?
Maybe it was like two or three.
He's trying to be modest. Jared, I want to jump to yourself. Kind of jumping off of the same question that David asked about finding work in this time. As an actor, sort of, what do you work, apart from When the Screaming Starts, what sort of plan are you setting in place? And I don't mean to cause an existential crisis if you don't have a plan already, but what sort of plan as an actor are you formulating that you may want to share with other actors who are feeling that sense of anxiety because of what we're going through at the moment?
It's a very crazy time. I think, I mean, obviously, aside from kind of work, you know, we've sort of done like a lot of editing in the past, and also like a lot of filming of kind of non-feature stuff, but that's taken quite a big hit. But I'd say, I mean, for actors out there, just to, you know, I do like a few like little skits and stuff, and like a lot of the other cast members do as well on YouTube and things like that. Got a lot of friends, and I've been sort of thinking about it as well, doing kind of trying to get into some more maybe voiceover stuff as well, and having maybe setting up like a little home studio, and just like what yourselves have said as well, just trying to be able to work as much as possible from home, and because a lot of it has, especially kind of maybe more corporate and like other filming, that's sort of taken a really big hit this year. So yeah, I'd say, you know, aside from obviously trying to get the bread and butter to pay the bills, I'd say definitely, you know, if, you know, obviously you can't gather to create shorts or anything like that, short films, but, you know, use things like Zoom, like Facebook groups or WhatsApp groups, and just try and, you know, bounce around ideas. So when, you know, fingers crossed we can sort of early 2021 get back together. You know, you can sort of hit the ground running and go with projects that you've kind of worked on. Sort of, yeah, from this time.
Yeah, that's solid. That's a solid plan. Conor, I want to throw the same kind of question to yourself, because as a director, obviously right now you're neck deep in post-production. So I guess you can, you are still working with that. But what happens in that case? I mean, first of all, let me just ask, just to recap, how, if these two scenes, two or three scenes, are done, when do you think you might have the film completed?
I think we'll have to speak to Alan and a few of the other post-production team for that, but we're hoping to get it done as soon as we can. Obviously, this is a self-funded, low-budget film, although we are, you know, we're pulling out all the stops as much as we can. But that does sometimes mean things take a little bit longer, because we're getting some like top professionals working on the film, but sometimes they have to take other jobs in between and come back to ours. So it's kind of hard to give it an exact date, but we're hoping early next year. I'd like to hope by February or March we'd have a finished film.
Okay, that's fine. So then now, use with that in mind, since you've now passed it on to the post-production team to work on it, how are you as a director keeping your head above the fray, making sure that while you're staying safe, you're still staying sane, creative, and still working as part, you know, to keep yourself going? How are you doing that?
I mean, in terms of the feature world, it's definitely a case of scripts, working on scripts at the moment. That's the main thing I'm focusing on in this weird time, is trying to use this strange point in history to create content, have scripts ready to go, so that hopefully in the near future, when this does die down, we've at least used our time wisely and we've got a whole backlog of scripts ready to go. Because that's one of the biggest battles, regardless of COVID, is just having the material that you want to shoot that's feasible. Because obviously sometimes you have a script and you really like it, but it's like, are we going to be able to shoot this if it's got spaceships and aliens and God knows what else in there? So yeah, really using this time to think about future projects and laying some more foundations. And the day-to-day sort of side of things, I mean, I've just started working for a new production company, and yeah, that's keeping me more than busy at the moment. So yeah, just more day-to-day sort of video stuff, not feature films, you know, like commercial bits and pieces.
Excellent. David, you got a question?
Yeah, I was gonna just quickly pick up on that point. You said you're working for a new production company. Does this mean that you're going to be in front of the camera now?
No, so I'm still behind the camera. Along with Jay, I mean, we've kind of over the years had to pick up so many skills. So, you know, we shoot, we edit, we write, produce, kind of sound like jacks of all trades. I guess we kind of are, but it does allow us to kind of stay within the industry this whole time. And we literally support ourselves this way. And then we can make our own creative projects on the side. I mean, Jared, even before COVID, he's come up with a system where he can write, shoot, edit his own sketches. I mean, he plays all the characters as well. So he's kind of COVID-proofed himself inadvertently. I guess the more skills you have, the more you can just keep working in this kind of tough, tough industry.
Jared, this new project, is it something that we can see? Is it on YouTube, or you have a website that we can see it?
Yeah, so youtube.com/ Jared Rogers Word. It's, yeah, just little comedy sketches and little spoken word bits and pieces. But yeah, and going on from what Conor was saying as well, I mean, we started in 2012, I think, we graduated from Arts Ed. And we kind of had a 7D and a few lenses and stuff that Yas had bought and brought us together. And, you know, Conor had done a lot of film before, but I'd never done kind of film and didn't know as many techniques and stuff. But, you know, here we are. I mean, it is kind of 8-9 years, which kind of, you know, maybe someone watching wanting to start out or listening wanting to start out is thinking, God, it's a long time. But really, you know, you can start, and especially with iPhones, you might not want to, you know, shoot a full feature on an iPhone, but you can definitely do a lot more now than probably what we could have done back then with just, you know, things you have in your pocket. And yeah, I just say, you know, get the ball rolling, you know, get your friends together and get right. Well, I get on Zoom, get together, not actually in not actually physically get together yet. Hopefully after the 2nd of December, it will be a bit different, but we'll see.
And if you have to, make sure you wear masks and wash your hands and stay
apart
from each other. Yeah, it'll be very interesting. It'll be very interesting shooting a film with everyone being 2 meters apart from each other. It's still doable. Just stay outside, well ventilated, with boom sticks, you know, just boom. And, you know, the selfie sticks, just holding the camera and everyone measuring yourself apart from each other. So it's doable. Not saying you should, just be safe if you're going to do that.
I have actually seen a film that was shot using Zoom entirely. And you had the four or five different panels with each of the actors. And they told a story very, very effectively. And it was about the coronavirus, and it was very contemporary. So it can be done with Zoom.
Bijang Tong, film director, filmmaker Bijang Tong, who's a regular on the show. He's currently an executive in Hong Kong, but he's just wrapped on an international film called Lockdown, where he's got Xander Berkeley in LA, he's got a few actors in the UK, he's got a few actors in China, and they just wrapped recently on film. That's just entirely on Zoom. So yeah, there are people doing it, such as Bijang, such as yourselves, Jared and Connor, just making people like me just feel, ooh, you know, I may be able to step out into the public and do something and safely, if I can.
Let me just throw this at you. Is there a scope for you sort of like writing in this unfortunate time into one of your future endeavors?
Writing about COVID?
Well, not necessarily writing about COVID, but using the pandemic as a backdrop. So interactions via Zoom or what have you.
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously crossed my mind, but my worry is that it's crossed every other filmmaker and writer's mind at the moment. I think we're all in for many COVID-inspired feature films and short films. Not that that's necessarily a bad thing. I'm sure some people can have some very interesting angles on it. I just can't face writing about it right now. I think because we're in it, you know, maybe when a bit of time's passed and you've got more of a perspective on it. But right now it just feels too close to home to really go down that path.
Let me rephrase then. Not necessarily writing about COVID, but writing a story that takes place during the time of COVID, where the interactions are mainly by things like Zoom or Microsoft Teams or what have you. So you have that aspect, but the story itself is not definitely COVID, if you see what I mean.
Yeah. I mean, actually, it's a shame Ed Hartland's not on this call, because he's got a script that's actually based on Zoom, and I think it's brilliant. And I've kind of been asking him to really push that one, because it feels so relevant right now. COVID's, I believe, like a small part of it, but it's more about the interactions over technology. And yeah, I think it's a fantastic concept, and it's definitely something I am interested in helping him with if I can in any way.
Yeah, I think there was a film in 2014, that was way before COVID, obviously, called Unfriended, which is pretty much the same kind of thing. I think, David, that might have been the one you were thinking of, where it is kind of these four friends in different chat rooms, and they're talking to themselves over Skype, and there's a killer that is killing them one by one. A couple of different films that are like that. So it's an interesting concept. And Connor, I do agree with you. I think in the next 6 to 12 months, we're going to be getting a glut of films that are just COVID inspired. Just before we went into lockdown, one of my projects, I kind of converted it into a COVID inspired or COVID themed one. And then obviously we got locked down and I had to scrap it. So it's exactly that. So I want to just wrap up with one question for both of you, both Connor and Jared. As you've mentioned, this is a small budget film. What can our listeners do to support filmmakers such as yourselves in these times? Because, as you said, a lot of artists are struggling because of lack of work, lack of income coming in. How can we support your project at the moment before it comes out? What can we do to support you?
I mean, I think it's just that thing of, I think, you know, at the moment, it's not a monetary thing. It's just I think time, you know, to look at, you know, there are so many projects out there, and I mean, it'd be great obviously to look at our one, but yeah, just give the time to, you know, at the moment, like, follow the social medias and just have that little, I think Instagram has the little bell, I know YouTube does and stuff if you kind of subscribe, but yeah, just you know, follow the journey and see where, you know, not just ourselves but other people, you know, it might not be film, it might be music or theatre. Well, I know theatre is quite tricky at the moment, but kind of theatre groups anyway, and just, yeah, just give those people a follow. Maybe they've got like a blog or like a mailing list or something you can sign up to, again, free, and yeah, just kind of keep in touch and sort of give that follow, see what they're doing, and yeah, hopefully we can all reconvene in the sort of the new year when it's safer to do so, and yeah, I think that's the best way at the moment, because unless there are any you know, maybe there are going to be down the line theatre shows that, you know, you can pay a little bit of money to and kind of see like a Zoom stream or something, but I think that's the best thing at the moment, is to just get engaged through social media.
So with that in mind, can both of you rattle off your social media handles so people listening can get onto it? Obviously, we're going to attach that in the show notes, but if anyone isn't able to get the show notes, or when it goes out on Resonance FM, Resonance 104.4 FM, they can at least listen and go onto whatever social media platform to get access to you.
After you, Mr. Brew.
Social media handles? Oh, he's throwing me under the bus. He knows I don't know these off the top of my head.
Oh, wait, so, well, I guess our one, sorry, to reiterate, our one is on Twitter, it's at When Screaming, and then on Facebook and Instagram, it's at When the Screaming Starts. And you'll see us anyway, because we're always like kind of popping up, getting tagged in posts. So our ones.
Sorry, what Fantastic. About your own one, Jared? Your own Twitter or Facebook or whichever handle?
So everything, YouTube as well, everything's at Jared Rogers Words. I've tried to, it wasn't a very commonly used one, so I've managed to nick them all across the socials.
No worries. We're going to subscribe to it and start watching your sketches and your spoken word videos as soon as we can.
Conor, have you not got a social media handle at all?
Oh, my own. I do know my own social media handle.
That's what we were asking for.
Oh, apologies. mine is just Conor Boru across, all social media. So
yeah, that's easy. Easy enough. Yeah, so we can follow you there.
Conor Boru, you'll find me. I think I'm the only one at this stage.
So excellent. That's Conorbru.
That's the one.
Right. Okay, I started to spell it out just in case people there were thinking, okay, how do you spell it?
yeah, good idea.
You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
That was director Conor Boru and actor Jared Rogers telling us, or catching us up on, the project When the Screaming Starts is going. Thank you very much to the both of them. And as soon as that movie is done, we would love to have them back on the show so they can tell us all about it. I, for one, would love to watch it. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
And this is Spotlight.
You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I'm joined by two... did you say joined by? No, I'm joined... Yes, I'm joined by. Sorry, it's Friday evening, and my brain has gone to mush. So I'm joined on this show by two filmmakers. Please tell us your name and the project that you're currently working on.
My name is Nicole Lieberman. I am, firstly, the co-founder of the Female Film Club. I'm also a producer in the industry. I've worked on a feature film and short films. And I'm also the VP of Acquisitions and Business Development for the online VOD platform Herflix, which is films by women, for women, and about women.
And I am Liza van der Smissen. I am the other co-founder of the Female Film Club. And I work in the film industry as an actor, as a producer, and as an assistant director Currently, I am in post-production of a feature film, which we managed to film during this pandemic. And I'm in pre-production of another feature, which we will be shooting next week.
That is fantastic news. And I have tons of questions about the, I'm going to call it for now, written in notes, COVID film. I will come back to that in just a second. What I want to dive into first of all is the Female Film Club. Please tell us, what is the Female Film Club? What is it? How did it start? And how can people get to know more about it?
Well, it started the same time that this pandemic started, as everybody was in lockdown. There was the film industry shut down. There was a disconnection between loads of filmmakers, and we felt this need for loads of female filmmakers to still be connected to the industry, to still have hope, to still get inspired, and to still network as loads of the film festivals were moving online.
So yes, in one sentence, the Female Film Club is an online networking platform for international female filmmakers. So we have members from over 13 different countries around the world, about 10 different professions within the industry, and it's growing. Like Liza said, we started during COVID. So we officially launched on the 1st of August. And it's really beautiful to see the growth we've been having and the need that there's been for such a community, because we weren't the only ones that have been feeling disconnected, and we found that there was so much of a need for it. And women have been coming from all over, and people have asked us, are these your friends or people you know? And I said, no, I mean, these are people that are coming from places that I've never even been to. And it's really beautiful because there's such a common ground for all of us and such a common language. And we're really starting to build the sisterhood together. So it's very exciting for the future of the club. And it is I suppose it's a positive thing that came with COVID.
And it keeps developing. Like, it started as just a film club. We're having film discussions around female directed films that from all different languages, so not only English speaking. And now it has grown to a full on platform, a bit in between of LinkedIn and Instagram. So you have professional but also fun connections. It's not like corporate in any way. But there's also no bikini pictures on there.
And that's great. That's great, because I actually wanted to ask a couple of questions about that as well, because I mean, you're right in the sense that with COVID, it's a lockdown, and we've had conversations about how filmmaking is a community. And in fact, every film, every project you're working on is a community to come together to get the project done. And now that the pandemic has occurred and we are shut down, a lot of productions are actually sort of being closed down or shelved or stalled. And as such, how do filmmakers get to interact? And it's a great idea that you're coming up with the Female Film Club for female filmmakers to come together. Now, I want to start off on that point and then move forward onto a number of other questions. So obviously from the title of the group, it's Female Film Club. Am I right in assuming that I, as a male filmmaker, will not be included in the Female Film Club?
Well, first of all, it's for all female identifying filmmakers, and we are actively promoting and connecting them. That being said, if a man would join the club, we're not going to throw him out. We are free about educating everyone and being together, but we are actively promoting and are for women in the club.
Absolutely. And I wasn't trying to be political or contrary about that particular question. I just wanted to sort of understand, first of all, what the parameters were. Because if I didn't show up and I say, right, I'd like to learn more about film and films, like, yeah, that's great. But unfortunately, no, you can't join us. So it's good to know that I'm welcome in the group. Now, just to dive into some of the things that you might be talking about, spotlighting certain female filmmakers that may not necessarily get the recognition in mainstream media or mainstream filmmaking content, outputs. Can you give us some ideas of some filmmakers that have inspired yourselves as well that you tend to talk about in the filmmaking film club? some female filmmakers that you'd like to give a shout out to, that you'd like to get other people to be able to go and find out their work?
So there are, of course, the female filmmakers that everybody knows, like Andrea Arnold, who's amazing. We'd like to give a big shout out to Sophie Hyde. We're having an event with Sophie Hyde on the 2nd of December, actually, a Q&A with her. And she is the director of Animals, who the film came out in the UK, I think, a couple of years ago.
In the UK.
Yeah, and in the US, it came out 5 days ago, I think, on VOD. So we're very excited to have Sophie. And actually, Sophie, we looked at her film in the very beginning of the club. And
the very first film, yeah, we looked at all the way in April. So it's really nice to have a collaboration with her. And along that, we really want to champion non-English filmmakers as well from all over the world. So we have so many. Hauda Benjamini.
Yeah,
we have Benjamini, from yeah. Divines.
Yeah.
Brilliant French film. Mati Diop, also Atlantics.
Brilliant.
Fantastic film. There are so much, because you also had the We Are One Film Festival, which had brilliant Asian films. Which else? D Reese, actually, we looked a lot at with Mudbound.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's one that we actually talk about quite a bit. Laura Sampson, my fellow co-host on the show, she loves Mudbound. I still need to see it.
It's so good.
I always say it's on my list, and I have a couple of lists. It's on my good list. To watch. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I'm here with the filmmakers who are behind the Female Film Club, and Nicole and Lisa. They're telling us about their club, which is basically an online forum or an online networking event or networking community for film, to praise and promote female filmmakers in the industry, which is fantastic. Recently on a podcast with female filmmaker, there's a friend of the show, Jenna Suru, and we were talking about diversity and inclusion. I want to ask you ladies, in terms of getting more female filmmakers out there, what sort of ideas would you be able to suggest young women who want to go into the industry? What ideas would you suggest we can give to them who are listening right now that they need to be able to take on board to help them as they progress in the industry?
First of all, don't be shy from seeking funding. Do the applications, push yourself. Don't think you have less possibility than any male directors. So just do everything you can in your powers to get the films done.
And when you get your voice heard.
And have your voice heard.
Your voice matters.
And your story's told, because your voice does matter. I think, unfortunately, there's so many brilliant, even young female filmmakers that just feel quite insecure and maybe not as, they're so motivated and they have such a good story to tell, but yet they just feel a bit shy from going out there and telling it. So I would just say, just do everything you can in your power. And don't stop, because if you have a great story and you have a brilliant film, it will get seen eventually, but you need to push in all avenues to get it to the right direction. And come and see me with Halflakes, because we're more than happy to put your film online on the VOD platform and then have lots of people to see it, because Halflakes is now signing big contracts with some big studios. It's going to get bigger with time. So, and I'm more than happy to give them an opportunity to then get distribution for their film.
And find your tribe. Like, yes, a film isn't made by yourself. Find people that lift you up.
Yes.
Men and women who have the same ideas, who have the same vision, the same values, and work together. Don't be afraid to ask for help.
Yes.
And also have the confidence to lift others up, because you never know what you can give, even though you feel like you're starting in the industry. That's also why we started the club, really to make women able to lift each other up.
And yeah, that's a very good point, because it's sort of, you, once you've gotten up the ladder, you open up the door, or I'm mixing metaphors, you climb up the ladder, you help other people up the ladder, you open the door, or you walk through the door, you keep the door open for other people to come in. I completely agree with that idea. Now, and Nicole, you've mentioned Herflix. For those who don't know about Herflix, please tell us, what is Herflix?
So it's an online VOD platform, so they can all look it up, www.herflix.com. And it's a platform that showcases films by women, for women, and about women. And the president is a wonderful woman called Adriana Shaw, who's based in New York. And come and speak to me or join the Female Film Club, because when you join the Female Film Club, you automatically get a chance to send us your film to then be considered for distribution with Herflix. So it's non-exclusive for feature films and for short films. And we're more than happy to look at your work. And there are people out there that are interested in female-directed films specifically. So it's always important to, especially for a short film, I always say, because sometimes you do the short and you finish the festival run and you did great, and then the short just sits there. And then just your family and friends end up seeing it again after a few years, and you're like, oh, I made this film. And then I think, why not put it online, get more people to see it, get your name out there. And also then I think, how amazing would it be if in 5 years you become a big director, and then also for Herflix to have taken that film from the very beginning as a short film. So it's kind of a give and take from both sides. It's a nice collaboration.
Absolutely right, and I agree with that. It's a project I recently came across. I haven't dived into it. I do want to go in there and expand my knowledge. I always look for opportunities to go and watch new films and films from different perspectives, from, you know, other than my own. And obviously, other than the blockbuster Hollywood, you know, superhero stuff, which I will always go back to and always watch and always champion. But I came up from the indie guerrilla filmmaking background. I would still like to go and look at other type of films like that as well. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and we're doing Spotlight with two female, I'll explain why I don't like saying female filmmakers. I'll come to that in just a second. Two filmmakers who have started the Female Film Club, Nicole Lieberman and Lisa van der Smissen. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Yeah. Perfect.
In my head, I was thinking, I'm going to mess this up. But I didn't, so I'm great. Yay. I'm not great. The fact that I got that correct is fine. The Female Film Club, as we've been talking, is basically a collection for female to connect, an online network for female filmmakers to connect. One of the reasons why I don't like saying female filmmakers is not because I think female filmmakers aren't good filmmakers. It's the fact that you shouldn't be referring to yourself, you shouldn't have to qualify yourself as female filmmakers. You should just say you're filmmakers. Now, I'm coming from a point of view where I'm male, and Hollywood or the industry has been male dominated for so long. We've already had a conversation about how you can encourage young filmmakers to come up, young female filmmakers to come up. What advice would you give to those who are already solid in the industry that they can do to make it easier for that change to occur, where we're no longer having to put the prefix of ethnic minority filmmaker, disabled filmmaker, trans filmmaker, female filmmaker? What can we do, those people already in industry, what can they do to change that structure to make sure that we get to that final destination?
Well, representation matters before the camera and behind the camera. So just be aware through what lens you're telling a story. And then I'm not talking just male, female, non-binary. I'm also talking able bodies. I'm talking races. I'm talking all kinds of backgrounds. Make sure that you're representative of, like, we're all being conditioned and we're all having a view of films because of what our environment has presented us this amount of years that we've been alive. If you think about a horror film, the female protagonist, what would she look like? Is she a frail, blonde, pretty girl? Or can she also be someone that you see walking around in Brixton on a, I don't know, Friday afternoon? Like, think about how are we being conditioned and how can we challenge these things? If you look at the play I Am Emily, which was fantastic, the representation in that film was so great. You had women who were deaf. You have women who are, I don't like to say disabled bodies, but I guess you know what I mean. There were all kind of different backgrounds.
The expression that someone gave to me when on the show, actually, it was live on air as well. It was differently abled. So, yes. I understand where you're coming from. So, yes.
Let's go with that. Absolutely. Differently abled bodies and all kinds of backgrounds. And I think if you're in the industry, you kind of have a responsibility to tell the stories that everybody can identify with and can be inspirational for everyone. Of course, then the interesting conversation is also who can tell which story, which is a whole nother debate. But I think if you are accomplished and you are in the industry, let's make sure it's as inclusive as possible in front and behind the camera.
That's nice. I like that idea as well. Increase representation on both sides, because obviously if you just put it on the front of, if you just put representation in front of camera. So yeah, that's great as well. So we need to be able to see those characters that represent us so we can say, yes, we can make it. But if those stories are crafted by people who aren't living those experiences, it is not true. It's a sense where it's told from a perspective where those people who do experience that would say, that's not real. That's not how that kind of person would talk. That's not how that person would react. So in a sense, you need that in the back as well. Okay, we'll just one final question on the Female Film Club. And then I'd like to move on to talking to both of you about your film careers as it is. So if people want to find out more about Female Film Club, what can they do? How can they reach you on social media, etc., etc.?
Very easy, www.femalefilmclub.com. You can register for your profile. It takes 2 minutes. You have a 2-week free trial. So check it out. See if it's for you. We have amazing workshops coming up. We do a lot for mindfulness as well as mindset. As she said, we have Sophie Hyde coming, also Kate Kinnaman, the previous
president of Women in Film and TV UK. Yeah,
in fact, actually, you know, I wrote the note down. I barely write notes in interviews, but I wrote a note down. You talked about the session with Sophie on the 2nd of December.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
So how do, if people aren't members of the Female Film Club, but they want to participate, observe that particular interview, what can they do?
We actually also set up a separate Eventbrite. So if they want to buy a one-off ticket, we are selling them for £5 just to attend the Q&A with Sophie and the film discussions about animals. But if they want to become members of the Female Film Club, they can pay £4 a month and have other events included as well. So it's up to each person individually, but they can look us up on Eventbrite as well and find the event with Sophie Hyde on the 2nd of December.
Fantastic. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I'm talking with two filmmakers who have started up the Female Film Club, Nicole Lieberman, and I'm going to try it again, Lisa van der Smissen.
Perfect.
Okay, thank you. I probably didn't say it perfectly, but you're like, yeah, we'll go with that. It's okay. Nicole, I want to start with you first. Let's talk about projects that you've worked on. So you mentioned you were a producer. What's the last project you worked on?
We did a short film. Me and Liza did a short film called Next. We shot it a year and a half ago.
Something like that, yeah.
And then we did quite well in the festival circuit. We premiered it at London Independent Film Festival. We're going to also be screening it in Franklin International Film Festival, which will be on in a few weeks, I think it is.
And we won Best Film also.
And we won Best Film in London Independent Film Festival, sorry, yes.
That's fantastic. So, yeah. Don't you should lead with that next time.
I know, exactly. Yeah, I was under. And so that was a really nice project that me and Liza, was the first project we worked on together. And like we speak about this sisterhood and this community base, and what we did is we really created that on set. And it was really beautiful to see so many people come together to make something happen and put in all so much hard work. We had a makeup artist who was who was a woman who was actually also our truck driver for and like helped us move everything on set. We had people, everyone was just doing their maximum, and we had an 80% female crew, but we had a few amazing men also working on set with us, and the vibe was just brilliant. And you can
collaborative,
very collaborative,
from the top to the bottom,
exactly. No hierarchy, and we kind of really believe in that no hierarchy on set as well. It doesn't matter if I'm a producer and you know, someone is you have the sound, you have the DP, you have everyone who's just making it as collaborative as possible. And for us, everyone was equal on every single level. So that was a really beautiful project. Also worked on a feature film, which was a British Ugandan feature film called Imperial Blue. And we premiered at Raindance last year. So that did well. And I have a few projects in development. My background is actually in human rights. So I always try to bring the human rights and film together. And I have a few projects now that I hope slowly will come into development. I'm co-writing as well a feature film with Lindsay Attenborough, who's amazing.
And a member.
And a member and director and producer as well. And it's about domestic abuse and violence, but with a different twist. And also I have a period drama as well, something to do with the Holocaust and based on a true story and kind of based on the story of the book, The Tattooist of Auschwitz, but a different angle from that bestseller book. But all these projects are in development. So we're talking, hopefully in the next 2 years, we will move forward and see results.
Of course. I just want to go back because you mentioned that the British Ugandan film was Imperial Blue. Yeah. And the short you said was that Next?
With 2 E's, yeah. Next.
Oh, with two E's, Next to 2 E's. How can people get to watch Next and Imperial
Next
Blue?
Will be on Netflix by the end of the month, so you'll be able to watch it after Franklin Film Festival online. And Imperial Blue was still in the process of distribution, so people will have to wait for Imperial Blue.
That's fine. When it comes out, please come back on the show, talk to us about it. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I'm here with doing Spotlight with two female filmmakers. We've just heard Nicole Lieberman talking about the films that she's been working on. I'm now going to move on to Liza van der Smissen, who's going to tell us about the COVID film, which she just wrapped during COVID, and the fact that she started a new production in COVID. Please tell us, what's the production that you just wrapped up and what's the one that you've just started?
So the film that we managed to shoot during this pandemic is Another Day to Live Through, and it's a UK Finnish production. I got involved in this project from January as a co-producer, and it was just a fantastic story that got me from the very beginning. I did a degree research in flawed female characters in Western 21st century film, which is a lot of feminist film theory. And to finish that and read this script, I was like, yes, this is exactly what I want to make. So when something comes on your path, you just grab it with both hands and don't let go, even if there's a worldwide pandemic. Mm-hmm. So the fact that, of course, there were travel restrictions meant that I couldn't join the shoot in Finland. So I had to do the whole pre-production from here. Then, of course, let it out of my hands. But they did an incredible shot, incredible shoot filming it there. And then when we came back, I saw the rushes and it looks incredible. They're now in post-production. And we actually launched a Kickstarter campaign just for the last bit of post-production, which already has been 30% funded. But of course, if you want to share or help the film industry, Another Day to Live Through on Instagram and on Kickstarter, be much, much appreciated. But I'm really proud of the whole production. The director, Peter Simmons, has pulled through, and the lead actor, Lene, she's just been incredible from start to finish. So yeah, it was a dream working on this.
And because you're an actress as well, so did you, were you not, the fact you were a producer, were you not tempted to get yourself a role in the film as well? Or was it a situation where you read it and you said, no, you know, I'm going to put myself apart and have, be a producer rather than an actress?
Yeah, I think especially with a feature, it's super tricky to wear two hats at the same time and to do it both to the best of your capabilities. And this film, I could serve best as a producer. Also the female role, you need to speak Finnish. And Lena is just perfect for the role in every aspect. So she's would be, yeah, she is a much a thousand times better fit than I could serve this role. So I'm incredibly happy that she took on this role and yeah, she nailed it. And I could really help this project best as a producer.
Fantastic. And that's Another Day to Live Through, which is currently on Kickstarter. It's Kickstarter, right? Not so it's currently on Kickstarter. We're going to put links to all of that on the show notes for this project or for this podcast and the radio show for Film Club, Female Film Club, for Another Day to Live Through, for also for Her Flix. We can put that on there as well. It's fantastic the fact that you've actually been able to power through, carry on with these projects, organize the film network that you have online, the both of you, for female filmmakers, and the fact that you've gone through the production with Another Day to Live Through. You said that you're now in pre-production for another project?
Yes, I'm working on pre-production.
What project is that?
The film is called A Stranger in Our Bed, and I'm working there as an assistant director together with Cashman Harris, which is one of the best ADs that I've ever worked with. So we're going to start that on Monday. Thank God the film industry can still work. We're all having COVID tests and it's going to be tricky, but we're going to get it done.
That was the question I wanted to ask about with regards to the one that you wrapped up during COVID. I mean, we've been talking to other filmmakers who've come on and talked about their projects they're working on, and some filmmakers have had to park theirs while others have just powered on through. We already know some of the limitations. How did you manage to work around the limitations that have been put by the lockdown, by the pandemic, by COVID in general?
Well, we were very lucky because the locations that we have in Finland is a remote cottage in the middle of nowhere. So we could make a bubble of everyone in the production. And that all just went great. Simple as that. Everybody...
Yeah. It's easy, you get everyone who's, yeah, you get the entire crew together, yeah.
There wasn't even running water, everything had to work, and it was very primitive, but beautiful.
How long was the shoot?
We managed to shoot everything in just over 2 weeks, that's it. So pre-production down to a T, and then just go.
Now that's fantastic, with fantastic news. I'm glad to hear that the film industry or production companies such as yourselves are still thriving, even though we're in a point where there's a chokehold on a lot, especially on the entertainment industry. You know, even the big boys or the big kids, like, you know, Warner Brothers and Disney, etc., they're feeling the pinch. So obviously those of us at this lower level are still struggling, but it's great to see that you're both you, Liza and Nicole, are able to carry on and do your projects and still promote such community in the filmmaking industry. I want to thank you very much for taking the time to join us this week on Shoot the Breeze. Obviously, when you have more news about your projects, please come back onto the show. We'll talk more when we all get out of lockdown and we can go to the studio. Would love to have you in. I'll introduce you to producer Dave and to Laura Sampson, and you get to meet them and join the family that is shooting.
That's great. Amazing.
And that was Nicole Lieberman and Liza van der Smissen talking to me about the Female Film Club, as well as their projects that they've been working through on COVID. We would have a top five favorites this week, But unfortunately, because of all the good content we've gotten from our filmmakers, we don't have enough time. But we will return back to regular scheduled programming as of next week. We're going to have some wonderful guests joining us on Zoom for the radio show. So I want to thank you all very much for tuning in and listening to the show, Shoot the Breeze, on Resonance 104.4 FM. I have been Marcus V. Acko.
And I'm still David Campbell.
Said, thank you very much for listening.
And see you next week. Bye.
Bye-bye.